Robert the Coroner Drap here. We got a bit of work to do. Because last night was Thursday night SmackDown. Normally, I do a post-SmackDown review directly after the show. The only downside is I don't have all my notes. I'll get there. Well, no, screw it. I'll do it now. I don't know what it is, and I used to work at a fast food place, so I don't really get bent out of shape about, messing stuff up, because, hey, we're human. Mistakes happen. I'm not going to be mad that somebody, made a mistake. And if I had been there, let's say I was supposed to put mustard on a burger and I put ketchup. That's a small, uncharged inconvenience. So somebody coming back, hey man, I asked for mustard on this burger. Oh man, I'm sorry. Let me do you a favor. Get you taken care of. Boom, front of the line. Makes sense. However, when you have to pay for that mistake, as a consumer, I feel like they should go, a step further to ensure that you leave with not just your expectations met, but exceeded. Like, my husband went to McDonald's last night for our dinner while I watched SmackDown. He went there, and I'm taking notes. I don't notice that he's messaged me a couple times asking me what I wanted again, because he forgot. We're human. We forget stuff. So he just orders me a quarter pounder with cheese and bacon. On one hand, I'm like, eh. On the other hand, I'm like, you know what? It works. It was good. And then he said something. He said, like, that burger doesn't look like it has bacon on it. So I opened the top bun. Lo and behold, no bacon. He's like, man, I paid extra for that. So I had to stop watching SmackDown, because he didn't care. He was like, okay, well, even though I paid for it, screw it, it's done. I'm like, no, fuck it. I'm going back to McDonald's. I hop in the car, drive back to McDonald's. I'm like, hey, listen, I was just in here, or my husband was just in here. He ordered me a quarter pounder with bacon. There's no bacon on this. And as I would have done with somebody who wasn't charged for a thing, sure, no problem, get you taken care of, boom, front of the line, remake, done. Here's the problem. An expectation of you feel bad about this, so you maybe do, instead of two slices of bacon, do four, Instead of putting, in maybe like, I don't know. And I guess that's why I can't kick up too much of a fuss about it. I can't be certain of what I would have actually expected, and B, I've been in that situation, so I can't be too mad about it. And see, I haven't finished my first cup of coffee yet this morning. BD Dubs, you want to know what a good Christmas gift would be? New cup. I like them big. For those of you who know me, I got a pretty big paw, and I like having the big handle to put my hand in. This is a 16-ounce cup of coffee. just drinking some cheap Walmart stuff. It's actually pretty good. But, no, I mean, I feel a little bent out of shape, but not super. So we're going to go to the notes, and then we're going to try and work off of my memory. So I do apologize in advance, but fuck McDonald's. Straight out. Fuck them. This is Superstar Shakeup night number 2. For those of you who watch my Raw review, we had, let's see here, Miz and Maurice, Dean Ambrose, let's see, who else did we have? Curt Hawkins, who nobody cares about. We also had Bray Wyatt. Let's see, they announced a couple of other ones. Apollo Crews, Kalisto, Slater, and Rhino were also announced to Raw. Tonight, we start out with Kevin Owens coming out, and I wrote, I guess that means both Owens and Jericho are going to be on SmackDown from now on. He comes out, and he's cutting his promo and about, you know, oh, America's not that great. You should all be thankful I'm your U.S. champion, being the face of America. And he's shaved. I'm like, yeah. You don't look bad with it. You don't look bad without it, but I preferred the beard, dude. Gee, wonder why. Nope, can't place it. He's just like he's shitting on you on the states in favor of Canada. And I wrote, this is classic heel heat. Followed by the ever popular heel tactic of insulting local sports team. He actually started speaking French. There was a part where he spoke French at the crowd, and there was no reaction because, oh, I forgot, this country you only speak one language. Let me translate it for you. That means if there's any man who disagrees if there's anyone who disagrees, why don't they come into the ring and we'll sort it out. Baron Corbin then comes out, and I'm like, I would love to see these two just go at it, because unfortunately, and this is a problem kind of endemic of WWE, they want heel versus face, and I'm like, no, let's just go with a heel run, let's do this. Both of these guys are conniving, evil bastards, let's do it. You have something I want, and I'll do anything it takes to get it. And I have something I want to keep, and I'll do anything I can do to keep it, so it wouldn't actually not be bad. Sami Zayn then comes out, and I'm like, yay. He's like, no, yeah, I'm on SmackDown now. I want that. You thought you were going to get away from me. I can assure you this is very real. This is a thing. So, I mean, and I also kind of, at later points in the evening, I took to Twitter. Like, JD calls him dead on. He was very dead on. It was very nice. AJ Styles comes out, he's getting just massive chance. He's super over, and he even puts over Sami Zayn a bit. He's like, no offense, this show isn't about you, Kevin Owens. It's not about the lone wolf. It's not about the underdog from the underground. No offense, Sami Zayn. It's about me. Because this is SmackDown, the house that AJ Styles built. Daniel Bryan comes out very shortly after that and announces that this is the way it's going to work. Kevin Owens is now on SmackDown Live, but he has to go defend his title, has to go defend his U.S. title at Payback, because he was scheduled to do so before the shakeup. So this was a thing that was just, you know, set in stone, had to be done. But the twist is that whoever wins that championship match at payback has to come back over to SmackDown. So this means one of two things. Either A, we're getting Jericho as U.S. champion again on SmackDown, or B, the more likely scenario, we're going to have Kevin Owens retaining and coming back to face the next part of this is he announces that there's going to be a triple threat number one contenders match for the main event that evening. AJ Styles, Baron Corbin, Sami Zayn. Okay. Number one. Then we'll get to the reason why I'm super... Well, no, we'll get to that now. Number one. Randy Orton is going to face Bray Wyatt in a House of Horrors match for the WWE Championship. That was announced tonight. So... at Payback. Nobody knows what this match is going to be. Nobody knows what this match is going to do. You know? It's just, oh, we're gonna put together this match. It's gonna be for the WWE Championship. My end-all hope is that because they don't have Brock Lesnar year round. They don't. Because the WWE Championship has to be on the opposite brand from the United States from the Universal Championship. It is that whoever wins that match ends up coming back to SmackDown. So we have the opportunity to push or the loser goes to Raw, and that's how we get, you know, Randy Orton off of SmackDown in favor of Bray Wyatt coming back, and I'd be fine with that. And they can only defend it, you know. It's like he gets his next rematch at the next interpromotional pay per view, which I think would be SummerSlam. It'd be interesting for damn sure. The next match is Randy Orton versus Eric Rowan. We have not seen Eric Rowan in months. And they even tell him, oh, his new return. And he comes out with this weird sheep gas mask and this creepy music. It's not even like the Wyatt family music. This is Eric Rowan's music now. Sounds like a fucking, like those little jewelry boxes. It's crazy. You know, they do a lot of the standard Randy Orton spots, the power slam off the run into the ropes, the draping DDT, Bray Wyatt's sting hits, the whap. I'm just gonna call it the whap. He's on the Titantron, and he starts cutting this promo about how he can smell the fear off of Randy Orton, and that come in 3 weeks, he's gonna put him in the House of Horrors, you know. And he rolls out, like, it goes back to normal. And he looks behind him, sees Eric Rowan standing, I guess like standing outside, because he doesn't actually, he's not in the ring anymore. So he like rolls out like he's going to go after him. Eric Rowan just picks up the steps and like hucks it at him and hits him in the face. And that's a DQ. Even though earlier in the match, like, Randy Orton had run him into them. That's fucking stupid. Stop it. If you're gonna call one for DQ, Randy Orton should be DQ'd early. If you intentionally throw your opponent into the stairs, you should be disqualified, if we're gonna call that as a disqualification. And, you know, who knows? Let's just move on. There was a spot where I thought they were setting up for a table, like an announce table spot, but no, because Eric Rowan, after hitting Orton in the face with the steel steps, he goes over to the announce table. He pulls off the hood and I think he hits Randy with it and throws it down. And I thought he was gonna start pulling out monitors, but he rolls him back in the ring and does that full Nelson slam he does. A wasted spot. Why'd you do it? Didn't matter. You could have just, stomped on him a bit or boot pressed him into the turnbuckle or whatever, But no. American Alpha versus the Usos for the SmackDown Live Tag Team Championships. This was actually a pretty good match, all in all. Again, not a big fan of the continuous cutting to commercials, but it is what it is. And the other downside was, I this was where my husband came back with the food, and we discovered that there wasn't bacon on the sandwich, so I had to go to Mc I wanted to go to McDonald's and rectify the situation. Not had to, I wanted to. And when I get back, it's Mojo Rawley and Jinder Mahal. Okay, number one. Nobody cares about either one of these fuckers. Nobody. I don't care about Jinder Mahal. I don't care about Mojo Rawley. I don't care about the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal because WWE screwed it up. There's no way I'm gonna care. So I come back to a match between Jinder Mahal and Mojo Rawley, and apparently Rob Gronkowski is sitting in the front row, in the right behind the announcer's desk, and they get over there and Gronk splashes. Stop. Stop bringing in motherfuckers that don't mean anything. Stop wasting time with stupid segments. Unless you're going to build to something that's going to mean something for some reason, just don't do it. Stop bringing in celebrities that have no purpose being in the ring. Rob, shouldn't you be in the fucking gym to try and get in shape so that way next year when you go on the field you actually earn the millions of dollars that you're being paid for being a professional athlete? And the reason I say professional because spending your time both in Orlando, then in freaking Boston, and I didn't even watch the one after WrestleMania, so I can't be certain Rob Gronkowski wasn't there, but I'm open to hearing it in the comments. Quit bringing this guy in. Stop it. You don't need him. Build a storyline between Jinder Mahal and Mojo Rawley if you really want to, where their rivalry is settled like men amongst themselves. Don't just say, "Oh, well, we've got Rob Gronkowski on this thing." No, fuck that. Do it yourself. Quit being a little punk. Mojo Rawley wins. It doesn't matter. He clocked Jinder hard. I don't know if he saw what Jinder did to Finn Balor and was like, "Oh, you like working stiff? I'm a little snug myself. Let's do this." I would love to get to know Finn Balor better, and I may go back through some of the old NXTs to try and understand the character that he's trying to bring across, but it doesn't really matter. As, maybe they want to tell the same story again with Finn Balor on Raw. Let it happen. Let this guy tell his story. Let this guy's character come across and let him do what he does best, and that's wrestle a damn good match. Let these guys go out and tell a story. They didn't. They've been, like, I want to say it's almost like they had started the rivalry based on the fact that Jinder lost the Andre the armbar, and they wanted to keep it going because it gives the two men something to do. Inconsequential. Aiden English. Few things you got to understand about Aiden English of the Vaudevillains. Number one, it's tragic. It really is. Because his gimmick, his talents, he's actually a legit Broadway guy. Like, he can sing. He doesn't have a bad voice. It's not that he's not on pitch. It's not that he's not, you know, making music that doesn't sound pleasing. It's that nobody in the WWE gives a single fuck about music. They're there for the wrestling. Aiden English comes out, starts cutting a promo about how he's bereft of anybody else. Like, he doesn't have... This, I guess, this is kind of WWE's way of acknowledging the fact that Simon Gotch is no longer part of the WWE universe. And yet, the fact that I never watched a whole bunch of NXT. The match that got me into NXT was Sami Zayn and Shinsuke Nakamura, which, oh my God, we can have that now. We could have Sami Zayn versus Shinsuke Nakamura for a title. Oh, please. Seriously, dark match. Don't care. Watch the fuck out of it. I absolutely would. Put it on the network. I would absolutely watch that. Hell, I may go back later today and watch the TakeOver Dallas. And if you haven't seen it, go watch the TakeOver Dallas a match that Shinsuke and Sami Zayn had. It was amazing. Lost track. Hang on. Processing. Now, Aiden English is there. And it may be because I didn't watch a whole lot of NXT that I don't know who the Vaudevillains were, how good they were together. But I had them backwards. I thought Simon Gotch was, you know, the tall guy that was, you know, like a fucking brick shit house. And Aiden English was the one with the dandy mustache. And it was kind of the smaller one, but it was amazing. It was pretty damn good. I thought it was the other way around, but apparently I was wrong. This whole thing singing, it's not going to get over. It's not going to work. It's going to kill him. And I'm super glad. I'm actually kind of super glad that they're trying, but it's going to fuel somebody else. And sometimes that's your lot in life. You gotta help somebody else get over. Nobody's going to remember you as being that stepping stone for somebody else, but it has to be there. Ty Dillinger comes out, and you, oh God, the tens are super over. It is just one of the most over things on the fucking roster. I love it. Oh, another thing I liked was is coming up here. There's a short match. Ty Dillinger wins with the tiebreaker. To the surprise of no one, there was actually a spot at the very, very beginning of the match where he comes out and, you know, the bell rings and Aiden English is on his knees, just kind of, you know, he's like, yes. And then 10 10 10. And it's just completely baffling to him. And he starts losing his mind over it, I guess. It doesn't make sense. Ty Dillinger's super over. I like Ty Dillinger. His scrap with Sanity was good. I actually wish they would have kept it, you know, a little longer. He deserves the main roster call-up. He absolutely does. He's on a good brand that will make use of him, hopefully very soon, for a United States Championship match. For a mid-card title. He'd be a damn good mid-card title holder. That said, it sucks that we have to wait until fucking May before we're going to see any of that. And even later because, we'll get there. I think they went to commercial, they come back, and Dolph Ziggler is in the ring. He's cutting a promo about how you all, like, all the fans can be super happy and, you know, ultra excited about the roster shakeup, and that soon the new toys will lose their new their freshness, and it'll be the guys that have been here forever doing the work that they do best that are gonna be here as they always have been. Shinsuke's music hits. I fucking love Nakamura. I do. I don't know why this segment needed to take place. I didn't understand why he came out during the Miz's segment, other than the fact just to prove he was there. And that was fine. It's like, I could have seen an awesome segment between Miz and Nakamura, where Miz is just doing all the promo work. And it would be fine. It's kind of like, I don't know if I should say it this way, but I feel like it should be said this way. It's almost like having promo work against Sting. Yeah, he can. It's not a strong suit, though. He's a wrestler. And he comes out there, just everybody's chanting Nakamura, and Dolph's in the ring. And he, like, bows to the... Shinsuke bows to Dolph Ziggler that way that he does that slow, "Hi, how you doing?" And he's out there, he keeps wearing his ring gear. I keep thinking like they put him in a dark match or something, but for those that don't know, dark matches are basically matches that don't go on television or on the network. They show up where they want to pay guys for wrestling, and they want to have guys wrestle because those guys want to wrestle, those guys want to work, and they just, okay, we don't want to show this on TV because it's not where we're going, but like it was last night, it was Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho. It was like Kevin Owens and somebody else versus Chris Jericho and Seth Rollins. And Seth Rollins did a new finisher. One of my friends linked me the video, and it looked brutal. I'll try and see if I can't find that link. It shouldn't be too hard for me to do so. And post it in the comments. Let's see. He comes out there, and Dolph's like, "Listen, I've been here for a long time. I don't think you know who I am." I thought he was going to go, "Hi, I'm Dolph Ziggler." Because, you know, back in the day, that was his gimmick. Nobody knew who he was. So he's like, "Hi, Dolph Ziggler." But no. He's like, "I don't know. I'm pretty sure you don't know who I am. And I have no clue who you are." And the crowd answers him with, "Nakamura." Just starts the chants up again, just hardcore, ratchet up. Oh God, it was beautiful. And he's like, "I think that answers it. Everybody here knows who I am, even if you don't." And I guess he like motioned for the mic. He's like, "Dolph, you want this?" Yeah, come on. Give me the mic. Come on. My name is Shinsuke Nakamura. And you could, like, he was, like, leaning in and the camera angle was just right. You could still see his mouth guard. And I'm like, dude, you're not going to fight. But he comes out every time just like he's about to fight. The crowd starts singing his song. Like, starts singing the theme song. It was great. Tis at this point Dolph Ziggler makes the mistake of assuming that he can kick Nakamura. He, like, goes for a chest kick, and Nakamura catches it. He's got him up on one foot, starts walking him backwards, and pushes him over, and he tumbles over. He's near the ropes, and he's like, and he's standing there, he smiles, he leans back. God! Fucking Nakamura. He's gonna pick a fight with the whole roster. It's gonna be great. I mean, I don't know how long you can really keep. I don't know how long you can really keep showing Nakamura without having a match. And I really don't want to keep seeing him used like this for mid-card talent when he's definitely a guy who should be going after AJ Styles, and AJ Styles doing the promo work for it would be amazing. But that's kind of what we got right now. Let's see, I don't think there was anything else outside the main event. Main event, triple threat, Zayn, Corbin, Styles. It was a good match. Again, because I had gotten taken out of the note-taking phase of my review, I didn't write down any spots, but I really did enjoy the way that these three worked together in the ring. The ending came. There was a good Blue Thunder Bomb spot that I. Somebody please. Somebody's got to go rewrite this. There needs to just be a small tweak, and I thought that they were going to let it happen here because of the way he did it. When Sami Zayn hit it on Styles, he not only had the leg, he like leaned into it and pushed down on the other opposite shoulder. So he had the left leg hook and starts pushing down with his elbow because he's got the leg here. He starts pushing down with his arm on the shoulders. I'm like, let it win. Let it be Sami Zayn. Cause I thought going into this, it has to be Sami Zayn pinning AJ Styles, because AJ will do the job when he believes it. Like with Bray Wyatt. He knew Bray Wyatt had to get over, and John Cena was behind it. So, you know, why not push in that Bray is a legit threat? Hitting Sister Abigail will end a match, and that's all he has to do is hit it. But no, kicks out of it. I think Baron Corbin was outside the ring trying to get back in. Sami Zayn runs up, hits the Huluva kick. AJ does the phenomenal forearm and gets the 1-2-3. This pisses me off because AJ doesn't need it. AJ Styles should not be feuding for the US title. He's better than that. He deserves way more than that. Don't know why that happened. The US title is a consolation prize. It is the mid-card title. you want to give him a full-on WWE championship match because he deserves it. He should have never been in this match. Having Sami Zayn versus Baron Corbin and having either Baron Corbin, and either way, it didn't matter who won that one. That's the thing. It didn't matter who won it at that point. If it would have been just Sami Zayn and Baron Corbin. If it had been a regular match, and the both of those guys going out there and doing what they do best, putting on a damn good wrestling match, and having it go over all things. Wouldn't have mattered who won. It would have been great. Kevin Owens versus Baron Corbin, amazing. Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens for a championship with the history that these two guys have, fucking awesome. Let's do it. Let's roll into it. And in fact, the time that you would have had between now and then to tell the story of what happened between those two in the ring again, amazing. You know, it could have, and even this could have ended better. Like they get AJ Styles out because you want to kind of protect AJ Styles. And Kevin Owens comes down the ring with like a chair, comes down with the title, hits Baron Corbin in the face with it. You know, and you wonder why? Why did he do this? Because he doesn't know if he can beat Baron Corbin. He's cocky enough to know he can beat anybody on the roster. But in the back of his mind, he knows he can fight Sami Zayn and win. Done it a bunch. Why not, you know, take the safe bet? You don't know if you can beat AJ Styles, and even Kevin Owens versus AJ Styles isn't going to be a great match. I like both of those guys, but I don't think they're on, you know, the similar fight style, and I don't think they're on the same level. KO, running as he is now, maybe as a champion, give it a couple months. You know, let it run its course. Right now it's new. It's still a bit new. So, let it breathe. Give it time, then put him with a major title around his shoulder. But I thought he would come down there and interfere in it just to stop Baron Corbin from winning and putting Sami Zayn over. But no, that's not what we get. We get disappointment. Other call-ups, because this, you know, pretty much the end of the review and I just realized I didn't announce it. Sin Cara is going to be a part of SmackDown Live. Why? Because fuck your tag team division, Kalisto gets to be on Raw. So no Lucha Dragons. The only other one that I remember clearly was The New Day. The New Day are coming to SmackDown. Okay. You know, add some legitimacy to the tag team division, because the Usos apparently won, retaining. You need tag teams, you need oh, and the women. That was the other part I missed. Shane McMahon comes down in the ring to address the state of the WWE women's division. He gets all of the women that are currently on the roster, you know, Naomi, Becky Lynch, Natalia, then he starts talking about this, we acquired somebody, you know, she's a two-time women's champion, she's won the women's championship multiple times, she's second generation WWE, her dad is in the Hall of Fame, he's a champion. And he's legitimate in his own right. And everybody in the crowd is going woo because they think it's Charlotte Flair. And then he's like, Tamina, daughter of the late great Superfly Jimmy Snuka. I don't hate it, but I don't like it. She comes out with this, this just, I'm a bitch face on. Just the biggest, nastiest, meanest look on her face. It was great. If she's gonna be a heel. Not watched a lot of her previous work, so don't know. But she come back looking pretty jacked. And then I think the crowd started chanting, "We want Sasha." Oh, I guess you thought I was gonna say somebody else. Well, how do you know I'm not? How do you know I'm not talking about our greatest acquisition in the trade, Charlotte Flair? And she comes down in her WrestleMania gear, the peacock. You know, green, emerald green, and with the tails and all that. She does her spin, and it's like, okay, that's fine. You got where you wanted to go. You did what you wanted to do. And that's where I tweeted, at JD from NY206 calls another one dead on. The booze, the massive amount of booze raining down on her as she struts to the ring. It was great. But that's your SmackDown review, as disjointed as it is. Thank you for watching. Please like, comment, subscribe, do all those wonderful things if you feel like doing them, which I would be grateful if you did. And I will see you guys, I don't know when. We're going to try. We're going to, you know, do more news and rumors and stuff like that whenever, you know, they come up. So, later.